Praise the Lord. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. Merry Christmas. You still have a few days. Santa's still watching. You have a few days. I asked somebody, I won't point them out or drop their name, when they were walking in if they were a good boy this year, and they said they still were working on it. So they still have some time. You have a few more days. What is the 20th today? Not much time. I do have my Christmas tie on. Very lovely. I have my Buckeye socks on, Ohio State Buckeyes. Those are not marijuana leaves. Those are Ohio State Buckeye leaves. They are... Those are Buckeye leaves. Praise the Lord. So, got my Christmassy, football-y. Okay, now let's get holy. We got all that, get all the nonsense out of the way, right? We got to get all the nonsense out of the way. Praise God. Hallelujah. And if anybody's passing goodies around, you know, I sit over there most of the time. I'm up here today, but my family's over there. So you can drop off any treats over there if you want to. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let me start with Psalms 51, verse 10. You just stay where you are. Stay seated. Psalm 51, verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Hallelujah. Now, if it's all right, can we just stand together? Can we just take a few moments? If you close your eyes and try to get your focus on the Lord right now, and if you wanna lift your hands, you know, like whenever I got pulled over and I got stopped by the cops different times, and some of the times I had to get out of the car. You know, lift your hands. You know, you're surrendering to authority. So if we could just yield and surrender ourselves and humble ourselves to the power and the authority that God holds and that God possesses, our Heavenly Father. We can know Him as our Heavenly Father this morning before one day when we have to know Him as Judge. But if you don't mind just praying with me and exalting Him and magnifying Him. And if you haven't had a moment to repent of any sin, could we do that this morning? Lord Jesus, we praise You. We exalt You and magnify You. Lord, I surrender under Your authority. I step under Your authority right now, Lord, because I believe with everything within me that You have great power and authority in heaven and in earth and in all the universe, Lord, and that there is nothing happening, there is nothing created, there is nothing taking place that You are not aware of. You are aware of all things, You have allowed all things, and that You have put Your limitation on all things. And this morning, I come before You, and I yield myself to You. I humble myself before You this morning, Lord. I bow down before You in the Spirit and in humility today, Lord. And I ask, would You forgive me of the sin in my life? I'm asking for the grace, Lord, and the mercy that comes from Your throne room this morning, Lord. That grace that I need to be able to let go of anger and bitterness, that I would not harbor any bitterness, that I would not hold on to any grudges, Lord. That I would forgive every offense, that I would forgive those who have offended me. Lord, help me to forgive those who have trespassed against me today, Lord. And would You forgive me of the iniquity in my life? Would You search me, O Lord? Would You search my heart and my mind? If You should find any wicked or evil way within me, would You wash me? Would You cleanse me? And would You purge me? Would You create within me a clean heart? Would You renew within me a right spirit today, Lord? In the name of Jesus, and I command that we would be baptized with the spirit of a sound mind. Lord, baptize us with the purity of Christ today, Lord. Bless us with the humility and the integrity of Jesus Christ today. That we would be blessed, Lord, with a Christ-like attitude. That we would have the very character and nature of Jesus Christ. Lord, we come against every unclean spirit, Lord, that would work against us, that would try to fill this place. We take power and authority that You have given us right now. We command these spirits to be cast into the pit of hell, never to return. We loose the joy, the love, and the peace and the righteousness of God right now. We loose your spirit. We loose the will of God to be manifest. That your spirit would have power, Lord, in this place. That your love, Lord, would fill this place today in the name of Jesus. We loose the truth and the righteousness of God. In the name of the Lord, we command that every lie be bound. We bind every lying, deceiving spirit in the name of the Lord Jesus. Oh, God, that you would have control in this place. That you would have control in our bodies right now, Lord. That the fruit of our lips would be praise and thanksgiving in the name of Jesus. Can we give the Lord a shout of praise today? Can we magnify him above every situation? Can we exalt him over every sickness and disease? Can we magnify the Lord over every unclean thing? Can we exalt his name in this house, that he would be praised, that he would be magnified, that he would be exalted in the name of Jesus? I freely give myself to you this morning, Lord. I give myself in worship. I give myself in praise today, Lord. Oh, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hida kariyolo bo shanna halaka ilo. Hida kariyala ba shannam yala ba sannam yala ba shamna. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. He is a mighty God. He is a mighty God. And I just cannot get past the point of that night when the Lord allowed that angel to bump into me just for maybe a time as this, to where somebody else, maybe the Lord wants to allow that angel of healing to bump into you this morning. Maybe that healing virtue of God, maybe it's God's will for his virtue, his healing virtue, to touch you this morning. If you have an ailment in your body, if you're feeling sick in your body, if you don't mind, if you're troubled in your mind this morning, if you don't have that peace of God this morning, if you don't have the joy from the Holy Ghost this morning, if you just want to make your way to the front before we get to singing, before we get to any preaching, you can let God have his way in your life this morning. And you don't have to feel the weight of any sin that we might have, because we just took care of that. We asked the Lord to forgive, and he's a forgiving God. Now if you want to ask the Lord, Lord, would you heal me? Lord, would you look down on me this morning, and would you heal my body? Lord, would you look down on me? I know that you are greater than anything that is troubling me right now. I know that you are more powerful than any sickness that I might have in my body. I know that your name is above every name. Your name is above depression. Maybe you're feeling a little bit depressed this morning and you're like, I got to get out of this. Well, if you got to get out of depression, then you got to get out of your seat. If you got to get out of sickness, you got to get out of your seat and make your way to the front and throw your hands up and say, Lord, I want you to heal me. Lord, I believe that you can touch my heart and my mind right now, and let the Holy Ghost pray through you in the name of Jesus. And if you're not one that made your way up, if you don't mind just reaching out to those that are at the altar this morning, just spread your hand out towards their direction in the name, and speak their healing and speak the power and the joy of the Holy Ghost right now. We speak the righteousness of God. We speak the perfect will of God right now in the name of Jesus. I know that some people can be really depressed at this time of year. I don't believe that's God's will for you to be battling such a depression in the name of the Lord. This is a time of joy. Hallelujah. God with us in the name of Jesus. We bind the doubt. We bind the fear in the name of the Lord. We bind the unbelief, and we lose faith in God. We lose faith in God for the miraculous. We lose faith in God for the impossible right now in the name of Jesus. From this day forward, in the name of the Lord, when you lay your head down at night, hallelujah, right? When you lay your head down on that pillow tonight. From this day forward, I declare in the name of the Lord that every thought, imagination, and idea would be taken captive into the obedience of Jesus Christ. That the dreams and the visions that you have would be straight from the throne of God. In the name of Jesus. I bless your households right now. I bless your marriages. I bless your spouses. I bless your children right now in the name of Jesus. I bless you in your place of work right now in the name of Jesus. I declare that you shall find favor in the eyes of God. You shall find favor in the eyes of those that you come in contact with in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And don't forget, just as that star attracted those three wise men, remember, you're a star wherever you are. And I know that sometimes we get that little offense when people are staring at us. You ever walked in somewhere and the people are just staring at you? People, you just walk in somewhere and people just can't take their eyes off of you, and we get offended at that. We could get a little bit of an attitude, well, why are you looking at me? How about, you know what? I know why they're looking at me. Let's recognize why people are putting their eyes on us, because we got the Holy Ghost. We got the love of God. We got the joy of the Lord. You know what? Hopefully we're spending time with Jesus, and when we walk into a place, they're fixing their eyes upon us because the Word of God, if I could just be so bold as to say like this, is that the walking gospel that you and I are has just walked in and is now in their presence, and they're feeling the power and the authority that is in the Holy Ghost that we have brought into that place. We're bringing light into a place of darkness. Of course, they're going to set their eyes upon you, and help us, Lord, to have the right attitude, that we would have the attitude of Jesus Christ, and that we would recognize. People were running to Jesus. Ministry of the Saints. What has Pastor been teaching? That we have the same ministry that Jesus Christ had when he walked the face of the earth. You ever read in this book where the man that was bound up with the legion of demons ran to him? People are looking at you. People might start running to you and say, hey, you got something. There's something about you. I can't take my eyes off of you. I'm drawn to you. People were running to Jesus. People were bringing the sick to Jesus because they knew when he stepped on the scene, when he walked into a place, when he walked into an area, they knew that is where my hope is. That is the author and the finisher of my hope and my salvation. When you walk into a place and you got the ministry of Jesus Christ, you are the walking gospel. People are going to turn to you. People are going to look to you. People are going to run to you. And they might not even understand. They might not know why, but we've got to recognize they're coming. They're attracted to me for a reason. They're attracted to me because I have something for them. And they might be in need. And we might not be able to fulfill that need. I don't know how many times, you wanted to give somebody a monetary blessing and you just weren't able to do it? I tell you what, you speak the word. You ask the Lord to bless you, and because he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Lord, would you bless this family? I want to be able to bless them, but Lord, I know that you are greater. I know that you are stronger. I know that you are wiser. They might not need a financial blessing. They might need something else. They might need the love and the joy and the peace of God. Lord, would you give them what they need? Would you fill their storehouse with blessings that cannot be contained right now in the name of Jesus? Hallelujah. So we don't have to feel burdened. when people are coming to us, well, I don't want people running to me. Well, hold on, but I don't have to do anything but just be a vessel, just be a conduit. And sometimes it's just as simple as something like, how you doing? You know what? And they unload, right? A lot of times people will just unload everything, and we're like, I got my own problems. I don't know how to fix yours. No, we're not called to fix their problems. I'm not called to fix it. Hey, let's take hands and let's pray. I know the one thing that can fix anything. I know the one who can fix anything. Let's take hands and let's be in agreement right now. And you might be the only one that's opening your mouth, saying things out, but let that word come out. Let Lord, take this uncomfortableness, take this uncomfortable feeling. Help me to feel comfortable and praying in front of other people right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me be a vessel. Let me be a conduit for the miraculous. I want to be a conduit for the miraculous. Not so that I could be lifted up. Not so that people could say, hey, he did a great. No. God did something great. We took hands and we prayed together. And when I walked out of that place, I want to hear those stories. When I walked out of that place, God healed my body. God touched my husband. God touched my wife. God blessed my kids, whatever it might be, because that's going to happen. I believe it in Jesus' name. And if you don't mind, these altars are open to worship this morning as we're going to start to sing here. I don't know what we're going to sing. But you know what? If you feel like worshiping up front, feel free to do that. Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Just get a spirit of worship in this house. Yes, amen, in Jesus' name.
Sing this part with her again. Oh, how deep, how great is the measure of our Father's love.
How great
is your love for me. Sing it again. One more time.
Oh, how wide.
Yes, oh Lord.
Oh,
yes, oh Lord. In the name of Jesus.
How deep.
Yes, oh Lord. In the name of Jesus.
How great
is your love. Now would you express your love back to Him? He loves us. Measureless. His love is without bounds. For God so loved the whole world. No other God in all of history has ever done what our God has done. No other king has ever come himself and humbled himself and went through even the basic life of Christ, much less allow them to hang him on a tree. No other God has done this. In the name of Jesus, no other God would come himself to do what he has done. And I bless you, Lord, and I return your love for me, Lord. I return that love this morning in thanksgiving, in honor and in praise unto the one who deserves it, O Lord. For you have done so much in my life. So today, oh God, we come to adore you. We come to magnify. We come to exalt your holy name today, Father, in the name of Jesus. So today, oh Lord, our desire is to exalt and to adore your mighty name, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. It is good to see all of you here this morning. Thankful to God for you, for your faithfulness to the kingdom of God and your faithfulness to this building. This is the house of God right here. He doesn't dwell in buildings made with hands anymore. That was a time, but that time has passed, and now he lives in the hearts of men. We could only grasp the magnitude of the love of God that he would go so far as to humble himself and come and live among us and then allow them to hang him on a tree, and that he would bleed and die for the purpose of saving us, coming to live inside of us and to see us live for all eternity with him in heaven. Can you say amen for that? Amen. And Aunt Marilyn, I know that you want to go home. You've told the Lord to come get you, but he told me to tell you. He won't come 1 second later than he's supposed to come. Okay? And when he does come, that means he's done. He still has a work for you to do, Aunt Marilyn, whatever that is. Your physical limitations, it doesn't matter. But he told me to tell you, he's coming, but not a second too soon. He knows the day, he knows the hour. Amen. Praise the Lord. I do have a word from the Lord to share with you this morning, and I'm looking forward to doing this. I apologize for keep wiping my mouth. Apparently, I nicked myself, and I didn't realize that I have been bleeding, and so I have the proof. So I keep checking the corner of my mouth to make sure that I'm not making a mess, engrossing anybody out. So please forgive me. I'm sorry. I wiped my mouth, and I said, what is that on my handkerchief? I checked again, and it's still there. Anyway, must be that aspirin I took this morning. Thank you, Sister Becky, for that. Amen. It is good to have this opportunity. What I was going to say is I haven't had this opportunity in very often in my years of ministry to be able to preach what we would consider a Christmas message. And when you hear it today, you may wonder, well, where did you get that? Just know that I got it from the Lord. I don't believe that it's necessarily only at Christmas that we can talk about the birth of Christ. When you start talking about the life of Christ, and you start talking about salvation, you cannot escape the fact that God did come in flesh through the womb of a young teenage girl, a virgin girl. God came in flesh like us. That in itself is the most amazing story of all. And as I stated a few moments ago, no other God has ever done that. In all of history, at least from my knowledge of gods that have come and gone, and they are all little g gods as far as I'm concerned. There is only one uppercase G God, and his name is Jesus. And when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, in the likeness of men. Lived among us, walked among us, got hungry among us. He got tired and sleepy. He got grouchy. He got irritable. Just like you and me. You were amening me till I said that, but we might as well get honest. We do get irritable sometimes. It doesn't take much for someone to push our buttons, and it might even be the loved ones that we live with. Not saying anything about beautiful over there, but it could be the people we live with that know how to get under our skin. But Jesus felt us in every way. He knew our temptations. He knew our struggles. He knew exactly how we are tested. And he knows exactly where we are the weakest. And so he was tested and tempted in all of those places. Yet he did it without sin. That he might become our perfect example, our perfect high priest, if you please. Not just to bring a sacrifice, but to bring himself as a sacrifice, not just for 1 year, but for all eternity. He brought himself as a sacrifice to die for the sins past, present, and in the future. And he did that until he comes back. That sacrifice, that spotless lamb that was slain so many years ago, the blood from that sacrifice has not dried. If that sacrifice has not grown old, it hasn't become unable to work. Maybe I should get away from the knots. It is still impactful. It is still working in the lives of people even today. Because as Brother Barber led us into prayer this morning, he led us in a prayer of repentance. Isn't that necessary every single day of our lives? I haven't achieved perfection yet. Oh, I'm growing in maturity. I'm striving for perfection, but I haven't reached there yet. Jesus sees me that way, Carrie. He sees me in the completed version. He sees me as version 2.0. I'm still at 0.9. I haven't achieved Apple's 14.2.1.0 yet. But Jesus already sees me at the end point. He sees me at the day he comes when the trumpet sounds. That's how he sees me right now. But Paul said that in Galatians, he said, I haven't yet arrived. I haven't achieved that moment, I don't know if this is an okay word to use on Sunday morning, but I haven't reached nirvana yet. I'm sorry. It's a striving daily to reach for those things. I'm pressing, striving to grasp a hold of what has been, that has already got a hold of me. Paul, the King James uses the word apprehended. He said, I haven't yet apprehended that for which I have already been apprehended. He has me. I just don't have him. And the moment we start to believe in this life that we have him and that we have a corner on the work of God in our lives, and we're in trouble. He has us. We don't have him. I don't have a corner on the Holy Ghost market. It doesn't belong to me. I have it. It was a gift that was given to me. But at any moment in time, it can be lost. Yes, I know there is a segment of our society that doesn't believe that's possible. But indeed, it is possible to walk away and be away from the Father's house. And away from the Father's house is away from everything that the Father stands for. Amen. This is not necessarily what I was going to preach, but it's the flow right now. So I'm going to follow this until we change directions. But I am going to be reading from the book of Luke here in just a moment if you want to turn there. But the life of Christ is something we strive to understand. We strive to let the life of Christ come into us. And as we have been studying, and this is not going to be a continuation of the ministry of the saints, but on Wednesday nights we've been studying the ministry of the saints. And I believe today that everything that Brother Barber talked about is exactly right. If we allow the life of Christ to actually be realized inside of every one of us, we will become more like him, and then we will operate like him in the earth. Jesus never met a stranger. He was never turned off by anyone, no matter how bad they looked or how bad they smelled. Can I get a witness from anybody? Aren't there people in our world that we rub shoulders with that we would rather not? But Jesus never turned them away. The only people Jesus turned away were those who thought they were better than everybody else. The self-righteous. Those are the ones Jesus had a problem with. But the down and outers, the leper, that everybody said, stay back, you're unclean, don't come any closer. Jesus walked right up to the man and put his arm around his shoulder and drew him up close and said, I'll heal you. I'll take care of you. So we become more like Christ when we have become more willing to touch those that everybody else shuns and pushes away. But no buts about it. Jesus never turned anyone aside. And I believe that the scriptures teach us that neither should we. If we are the Christ to this world, then we need to show them who Jesus really is. And as I have stated a number of times, and since we only have one service today, I'm just going to take my time. And when the flow changes, I'll change. And I have stated this many times, that in Luke chapter 16, that Jesus told his disciples, he said, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he said, he will guide you into all truth. And that phrase, guide you into all truth, is literally that he will guide you into the full reality of truth. And what is truth? It's a person. Whoever said Jesus, you got it right. Truth is a person. So the Holy Ghost will lead us to become more and more like Christ until the day when Jesus comes and the trumpet sounds. Guess what? When that day arrives, whatever is left lacking in my striving to be like him, he's going to change me in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, and I will be just like him. But on this earth, we are striving to be like Jesus. Anybody remember that song? To be like Jesus on earth alone. To be like him from earth to glory. I don't know that line. I only ask to be like him. Father, in Jesus' name, this is what we want. Lord, we want you to be formed in us. That, Lord, when the world looks at me, that they see someone that doesn't look like everybody else. Because, Lord, you stood out, not because of what you look like, but it was because of what was in you and what was coming out of you, Lord, that attracted the lepers to you. It attracted the blind when they cried, Jesus, have mercy on me. It was that was in you, Lord. So I am praying, oh God, this morning that your spirit will be perfected in us, and that, oh Lord, we will look like you, we will act like you, we will talk like you, we will live like you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You're dismissed. No, I'm just kidding. That was rude. Luke chapter 1, verse 1. I promise I will not be long. I have a long drive today, and it's not just because of that, but I won't be long. Luke chapter 1, beginning at verse number 1. Luke says this. For as much as many have taken in hand to set forth in order a declaration of those things which are most surely believed among us, even as they delivered them unto us, which from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word. It seemed good to me also, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, to write unto thee in order, most excellent Theophilus, that thou mightest know, listen, he said, I'm writing this that you might know the certainty of those things wherein thou hast been instructed. Today I want to preach for a little while, O come, let us adore him. If you are anything like me, you had an opportunity to go to Sunday school when you were a child, and you sat through the classes, you heard the teachers teach, you saw the flannel board with the little figures that would stick to the flannel board, and the teacher would take those and move them across the flannel board, and the boat would be there, and all of the little figures and examples that they would use to teach us about Jesus. And as a child, there were many things that we didn't understand, but we did know that there was a man that lived a long time ago, and his name was Jesus, and he did a lot of wonderful things in his earthly ministry. And we heard that we heard that he healed the blind, and we heard that he raised the dead, and we heard that he opened the deaf ears, and he caused the dumb to speak. We heard these things. We heard that there was a time that he actually walked on water. When Peter walked on the water himself, but in John's version of that story, in John chapter 5, Jesus walked for some 6 or 7, maybe 8 miles across the Sea of Galilee to get to where the disciples were. We heard that story. We know that it was a long way because John gives in that story, he gives the fact that they had rowed 25 or 30 furlongs. Why would John give that detail if it wasn't important? They were right smack dab in the middle of the Sea of Galilee at a point where they could not go back, they could not go forward, but Jesus walked across that sea up and down those waves because it was a mess that night. You heard that story, Brother Barber. And as a child, you know, we might have been amazed for a moment or two, and now that we're an adult, it seems pretty far-fetched that that actually happened. Unless you have faith. Then it's true. It's in the Bible, so it must be true. It's not like that State Farm commercial where the girl's going on the date with the French model because she met him on the internet, and they can't put anything on the internet that's not true. Well, we know that's not true. But we read it in the Bible, so we know it's true. But if you have no faith to believe that God is who he said he is and that he will do what he said he will do, then this right here is nothing more than just a big hoax. It doesn't mean anything. As a matter of fact, as powerful as God's word is, it is powerless if we have no faith to practice it or to exercise our faith based on what this word says. So Luke writes to us, telling us, well, he's writing to someone that he calls Theophilus. And he says, I'm writing to tell you, to set forth, to lay it out there before you, something that is very surely happened. It's believed among us. And I said, I want you to know beyond the shadow of any doubt the certainty of what has happened, the birth, the life, the death, the burial, the resurrection, the ascension, the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, because that had already happened when Luke wrote his book. He says, Theophilus, I want you to know the certainty that what has occurred will surely supply every doubt that you have with enough faith to believe if you will only exercise what you have heard about the Christ. Those things which are most surely believed among us. Verse 4, that thou mightest know the certainty of those things wherein thou hast been instructed. Now, if you will allow me, I want to read those 4 verses in the Passion Translation. It's aggravating as all get out. It'll be all right. We'll get through it. I have about 3 or 4 pints left. I'm good. In the Passion Translation, it reads like this. I am writing for you, mighty lover of God, an orderly account of what Jesus, the Anointed One, accomplished and fulfilled among us. Several eyewitness biographies have already been written, using as their source material the good news preached among us by his early disciples, who became loving servants of the living expression. Now, well, let me finish and then I'll elaborate. Using as their source material the good news preached among us by his early disciples, who became loving servants of the living expression. King James uses word, W-O-R-D. But now I am passing on to you this accurate compilation of my own meticulous investigation based on numerous eyewitness interviews and thorough research of the story of his life. It is appropriate for me to write this, for he also appeared to me so that I would reassure you beyond any shadow of a doubt the reliability of all you have been taught of him. There is a line in this, in the Passion Translation, that is basically has to be true for every one of us, and that is this. He said, I'm writing this accurate compilation of my own meticulous investigation based on numerous eyewitness interviews and thorough research of the story of his life. Then he says this, it is appropriate for me to write this, for he also appeared to me. See, Luke could have stayed with his investigation. He could have stayed with his research. He could have stayed with his study books that he went and found at the library and got a bunch of information. He could have stayed with that, but he didn't stop there. And this has to be true of every single person in this room today. Luke ended those four verses when he said this, for he also appeared to me. What makes those other statements he made so powerful is because Luke was, yes, he went and found eyewitness accounts. Yes, he did some of his own interviews and investigation, but he said, you know what? I have more proof than just what others have seen and heard. He said, I saw him for myself. I don't know if Luke saw him in person. I don't know. Just like the Apostle Paul said. And last of all, Paul said he was seen of me. But Paul came along after the death, burial, and resurrection and ascension. So I don't know about Luke. Did Luke see him before, or was this after the fact when Luke had his own personal revelation of Jesus Christ? Jesus appeared to him in some form. And can I tell you today with all of my heart that as powerful as this word is, if it is not taken internally, if it is not accepted for what it is, that it is the word, not words. This is one word of God, from God. This is God's will, plan, purpose, and design for all of mankind right here. This is eternity. This is life after death. And if this is not appropriated and taken into every one of our lives, then we have no hope in the hereafter. Can you say amen to that if you believe that statement? Because if you die without ever having this become real to you, if you go into eternity, well, this is Christmas, Pastor, what are you doing? Well, I've got to tell you the truth. If this is not appropriated, if this is not taken internal and internalized and then made into my daily walk and my practice that I do every single day, then what good is it? It will do nothing for me unless I accept it by faith and then I find out what it says to me. It's true, okay? First of all, I have to be convinced. I have to be persuaded. Somebody tells you, they use words, and they tell you about Jesus. So then in those words that are being used to tell you about Jesus, now I have to be persuaded in here that what they are telling me is true. And when I am persuaded that what they tell me is true, then according to the scriptures, I now have faith. But until my faith is then exercised, what do I do? Well, if I believe this is true, then I have to peruse it every now and then. I got to go look inside and see, well, what is the Lord saying? If I believe he is who he said he is, and I believe he will do what he said he will do, Sister Susie, then I need to find out who he is and what he is and what does he want to do with my life. Or you can just say, you know what? I believe. You can leave it at that. But just simply having faith is not enough. The devils have faith. Isn't that what the scriptures say? The devils believe and tremble. That means that the devils have faith, but they can't exercise it. They know that they've heard about Jesus, right? Those fallen angels, they were in heaven. They knew that there was something coming. They didn't know what was going to happen, but they knew something was coming. And then when Jesus finally came to the earth, oh, they knew who he was. And so they believed that there was a Christ, and they believed in him, but they could not do anything with their faith because it's impossible for the devils to be obedient to God's word. They believe and tremble. But James said right after that, but you must know, O vain man, that faith without what? Works is dead. And this is a far out Christmas message today, Pastor. I know, right? Far out, indeed. You know what era I grew up in. Ralph, far out Ralph. I had a science teacher at Clute Intermediate. His name was Ralph Moore. Don't say far out Ralph in his class. He had a class ring that he would turn that thing upside down. Pop you on top of the head. I got it. So I hear about Jesus. I believe in Jesus. So Luke is telling us, I want you to know the certainty, Theophilus. But you have to have this meeting for yourself. So in Luke 1, in the Passion Translation, he uses the phrase living expression as Luke used in verse 2, ministers of the word. And so whoever the translator is in the Passion Translation, this is what he says about the word. W-O-R-D. And he translated it literally from the Aramaic to living expression. He says the Greek word is logos, where we get, which is word, which is what John said about him. The word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That's the word logos. He says some have translated this rich term as word. It could also be translated, listen to this. This word could also be translated message or blueprint. Jesus Christ is the eternal word. He is the creative word. He is the word made visible. Jesus Christ is the divine self-expression of all that God is. Listen, all that God contains and all that God reveals in incarnated flesh. Just as we express ourselves in words, God has perfectly expressed himself in Christ. So when Luke wrote what he did, he wrote it from the standpoint of I have met him. I have experienced him. Not only did I read about him, but I learned firsthand who Christ is and what Christ did, and now what he still does in the lives of believers. You see, the birth of Christ is something that is pretty amazing. These last few days, I have been reading it over and over. I read Luke's account, and then I read Matthew's account. And I have gone back and forth looking at each one of these. And in my mind, I see it. In my mind, I understand what took place. That God, the Almighty, the Spirit of God, overshadowed Mary. She conceived and she bore a child. For the angel told her, that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Who does that? What God in all of the world would do such a thing, to humble himself, to bring a life into this world that would eventually live and die? But you see, he had to do this because it was his plan from the foundation of the world, right? Revelation 13 and 8 says that Jesus Christ was slain from the foundation of the world. So we know this was in the mind of God, and yet he created the garden, yet he created Adam and Eve and put them there on purpose. Did God know they were going to eat from the tree? Yes, he did. And yet he still did it. Why? Because God so loved the world before there was a world. God loved mankind before he created Adam and Eve. He loved us even today, you and me. He saw us before the foundation of the world. Then when Adam rebelled against God and ate from the tree, and dominion was lost in the earth, and now Satan comes in and he takes over, and now the earth is destroyed, and then a flood comes, and on life goes, and men and women getting more wicked and wicked every single day. And now here we are 21 centuries later, that we are aware of, since the time of Christ, the thousands of years that were before that, and the numbers of people that sinned and done all the wickedness of the world, and yet here we are, living in a time and a period of grace where God is not winking at sin, but God is long-suffering of sin. So I'm recounting this story in my mind these last few days, grasping why, how. And the problem that we face today is that the culture that we live in, the cancel culture that we live in. Did anybody read the article of the nurse in Minnesota that put lights on her home? She is a COVID ward only nurse in Minnesota. So she put lights on her home, just something to encourage herself when she come home from work, and the lights on, and the trees, and the yard, and the house, and just the pleasure of having the lights outside in the snow. And she got an anonymous letter. And the person was very pointed with their words and talking about this, that she should be ashamed of herself for putting lights on her house in a time like this, when not everybody could afford to put lights on their house, and to be so insensitive as to believe that we all believe in Christmas and we don't. And this writer was suggesting that she needed to take them down, because not everybody has the money to put lights up. So if we can't have it, neither can you. That's the cancel culture we live in. I don't believe in it, so therefore, you can't have it either. That's the mentality, not only to Christmas lights on someone's home, but that's the mentality that the world has regarding Jesus Christ and the fact that he came to this earth to seek and to save that which was lost. What was lost was humanity in the garden was lost for all eternity unless God did something about it. And you want to tell me, you want to try to cancel out what Jesus Christ has done for all of humanity, if only humanity would believe it. You can cancel it out for yourself if you want, but I choose to believe, and I choose to believe it openly. My wife and I went to town the other day. We actually went to Hobby Lobby, but I didn't get out this time. She said I could just stay in the car. So her and Matthew went in, and I slept in the car. I could not keep my eyes open. Oh, it was horrible. But that particular day, maybe it was the day before. It was the day before. That's what it was. We went to several places, and I told several people, Merry Christmas. With my mask on, you know, you can smile with your mask, and they know you're smiling. And they ignored me. And I said, you know what? That ticks me off. I'm going to keep saying it. Somebody's going to reply to me, Merry Christmas. I don't care. They're going to tell me. So I just kept doing it. Finally, I got somebody. Well, it was the lady that's taking your number when you walk in the door. She's counting how many people go in the store. They got that little calculator, and they're counting how many folks come in. And I stopped at the table. Oh, yeah, she said it first. And I said, I should have done that right there. And I stopped and I told that lady, I said, thank you. I said, you're the first person that has said it. I've said it to several people and nobody. And I told her, I said, I'm just going to keep saying it till somebody tells me. We went in the store, kept doing it. Anybody that would make eye contact, you know, I would tell them, Merry Christmas. I didn't do it 100 times. And we walk outside the door and there's the lady ringing the bell. For Salvation Army, stopped at the kettle and had a little conversation with the lady, and I told her Merry Christmas, and we had this conversation. You know what? It started at Sonic. That's where it started. I told that lady Merry Christmas, and she just looked at me. That's the culture. I'm not satisfied to just acquiesce to the culture. Jesus was counterculture. He didn't dress like everybody else. He didn't act like everybody else. He went against the grain, even when it was going to cost him his ever-loving life. He said, you know what? He told those Pharisees, you're hypocrites. You're just white as sepulchers. You're just full of dead men's bones. That's all you are. And then the lawyers in one place, Jesus was talking about how terrible the Pharisees were, and the lawyers came and he says, all you're telling them, it makes us look bad. Then he said, okay, well, thanks for showing up. Bam! And he landed on the lawyers and started telling them about how wicked they were in the Bible, okay? Jesus was counterculture. But yes, we are supposed to be counterculture, but we're not supposed to be rude about it. Because if you go read 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and Brianna, if you want to throw that up there real quick, I promise I'm going to land this thing. 2 we've been given this Christmas story. Sister Susie, I'm sorry, I probably didn't touch on the part that you liked the most, but it is a Christmas story, because had Christ not come, where would we be? If there hadn't been a Noah, if there hadn't been somebody to find grace in the eyes of the Lord, where would we be today? And if Christ would have been willing to just do his own thing and live his own life and just promote his own self and make an earthly kingdom for himself, then here we would be. We would be of all men most miserable. But Christ has come for us. God in flesh came to us. So what do we do with what he did for us? Yes, Luke says that We have to have this meeting for ourselves. We have to accept the gospel for ourselves and have this visitation with the Lord. And let this living expression of God Himself change our lives through repentance and through water baptism in Jesus' name and accepting and believing the full gospel. Now that we have received this full gospel, Paul in verse 14 says this, 2 Corinthians 5, he says, "For the love of God constraineth us." What? Why does the love of God constrain us? Because what we have received now constrains us, because we have experienced the love that He has for us. Now inside, that love is driving me to tell somebody Merry Christmas, and they're going to tell me back. I'm not going to stop until they do. It wasn't because I was just itching for a fight. I was just itching for somebody to connect with me. It seemed like it, because it gets under my skin, and I was a little animated when I was telling my wife, and man, somebody's going to tell me Merry Christmas. It's the last thing I do. Yes. Yes, I did say it just like that to her. Why? Because I've experienced this love. God's love has come into me. He loved me, Sister Annie. He loved me even when I was full of sin. When my heart was black. And I had no hope in this world. But He loved me. Gave His life for me. God so loved the world. And He loved us through the man Christ Jesus. This holy, omnipotent, infinite God came into our eternity, in our time and space. How much did He have to humble Himself to do that? Psalm said He has to humble Himself just to look at the stars. Yet He came from infinite. He made a way to get into our world. Time and space, and here we have now this great gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that now what we did not have before has now been opened up to, like a great door just opened up through Christ Jesus. Read the book of John sometime. Slow down and read through the book of John and listen to the times where Jesus told His disciples. The Bible, the prophets of old said, everybody will be taught of God. And then the very next verse, Jesus said, and I'm going to be the one doing the teaching. Jesus was saying, I am God in the flesh. And if you want to get to the Father, guess what? You're just going to have to come through me. No one's going to be able to get anywhere closer to the Father than right here, Jesus said. So that love of Christ has now moved inside of me. Guess what? How is the world going to ever get to Jesus if the love of Christ is not constraining me, just pushing me, driving me to find somebody that I can connect with, somebody that I can tell Merry Christmas to you and they will love me back? Yes, the ministry of Christ. You and me operating in the earth, doing what Jesus did when He walked the earth. Yes, that's our ministry. I have proof. Shirley, play something. Okay, give them hope. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. And that He died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto Him which died for them and rose again. He says, wherefore, henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. Yet though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. See, we don't know Christ after the flesh. He's not here anymore. How do we know him? Because Luke said, he appeared to me. He has appeared to me June 15th, 1975. Jesus appeared to me. I don't know him after the flesh, but I know him through the power of the Spirit. Verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. If I'm not mistaken, that's present tense. That's not past tense, because I'm not perfect yet. This is present tense work that God is doing in me right now, because daily, old stuff should be daily falling away. Daily, old stuff should be passing away. Behold, all things are present tense, become new. So that means it's happening right here, right now. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself. Hear the word of the Lord right now. All things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. I didn't know why I was doing what I was doing the other day. When God brought this to my mind, this actually verse 19 is what God brought to my mind this morning. I didn't realize what I was doing, Brother Barber. But the ministry of reconciliation was working in me on Thursday. Because there's a lot of people in this world that, for whatever reason, they've lost the reason, or they've lost the passion, or they've lost the desire to still believe in Christmas. It's not about Santa Claus. Just for the record, I still believe. If there's not one, I'm him. So I still believe in Santa Claus. Yeah, it sounds crazy, doesn't it? But I believe in Christmas. Yes, I know she can't believe I'm saying this. If it was left up to me, all those crates would have been left at the storage building, and that Christmas tree would have stayed in the box. Something's changing, baby. I'm changing. I'm changing. I might even help you decorate the thing next year. Why? Because I don't want to lose my first love. I don't want to lose Aunt Marilyn. I don't want to lose what Jesus has done for me. He gave me this precious gift. He rescued my soul from hell. Anybody with me right now? Anybody else's soul on their way to hell? And he found you in the nick of time. Picks you up out of the miry clay, set your feet on the rock to stay. What did he give you then? He gave you now. He gave you not only his gift. Sit down, I ain't done. Not only did he give you his gift, but he gave you a ministry. Oh, I didn't realize this, Brother Barber. This is just a continuation of the ministry of the saints. Now we just finally got ourselves right into it. He gave us a ministry, Sister Susie. He gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Reconciliating who? Those who are still estranged from their Father. That's what Jesus came to do. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. Sister Shirley, hit the other pedal, that down pedal for a second. You can keep playing. It's okay. I know you're getting excited too. We've been given a ministry to reconcile those who are estranged from their dad and bring them back. How do we do that? It's just very simple. Merry Christmas, young man. Awesome. Made my day right there. Seriously, that's the ministry of reconciliation, because you know what? It brought a conversation into being that wasn't going to happen the other day, that lady ringing the bell at the kettle. It brought a conversation about Jesus Christ and what it meant to her and what it meant to me. Just by saying Merry Christmas, that's all it took. So I was reconciled to another human being. And we were reconciled to our Father in heaven. And we've been given that ministry. But this is the scripture. Before the light ever came on in any part of the house this morning, this is what the Lord said to me. I got to read 18 to get it. So, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. You know what that reconciliation means, right? That's people who were estranged from one another, had their differences reconciled. And that word reconciliation is an adjustment of a difference. It's restoration to favor. Restoration to favor of God to sinners that repent and put their trust in Jesus Christ. And he says, we have been given the ministry of reconciliation. Verse 19, to wit, King James 4:4, F-O-R, 4, God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. For God so loved the world. That when Christ came, God, this is where I was going a while ago. God, who could not, because of his holiness, could not come to where we are in his, that spirit state, that infinite God, that eternal God that came into this realm, could not meet and walk with men because Adam sinned, right? That separation was brought about in the Garden of Eden. And so therefore, God no longer came in the cool of the day, so there was separation. But God was in Christ, made like unto you and me. He put on flesh, and God, through Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. In fact, Psalm 32, when you get a chance, just read that. Psalm 32 and Psalm 51 are some very amazing verses of Scripture. But he said, I'm not imputing their trespasses unto them. He said, instead, I'm forgiving them. And then this is what he said, and hath committed unto us. He gave us the ministry. Now he is giving us the word of reconciliation. And this is the word that the Passion Translation defined as living expression. Does it make sense? Because as Jesus was in flesh, we have been given the living expression right here. And so now what was described of Jesus, the message, the blueprint, Jesus Christ is the eternal word, the creative word, the word made visible, the divine self-expression of all that God is, contains, and reveals incarnated in incarnated flesh. Just as we express ourselves in words, God has perfectly expressed himself in Christ. Here's the whole point. God has given us the living expression, Christ in me. Somebody finish it. The hope
of glory. Oh, come, let us adore.
Sing it in your key. Sing.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord.
Why should I? Why should I? Just keep playing, because we're going to do this a few more times. Okay. Why should I adore him with everything within me? Or maybe I should say, why shouldn't I? Why should I not be eternally grateful and filled with love and compassion for what the Christ has done for me, but not only what he has done for me, Sister Susie, but what he wants to do through me? He's already done in me and still continues to do in me what he wants to do, but he wants to do through me. He gave me the ministry. But he not only gave me the ministry, but he gave me the word, the living expression, Jesus Christ himself, living in me, now being expressed through me in a Merry Christmas. That's all it takes. If that's all I can do, then I'm going to say Merry Christmas. And if somebody wants to cancel me out, then fine, cancel me. That's okay. And she hopes they don't cancel me out forever. You can cancel. You can put me in that, on that list, in the cancel culture. Put me on that list and tell me, you're a wacko, you're a nut job, you don't belong. It doesn't matter what the world thinks or believes. In Christ, I am a son of God, and I am alive forevermore. What you see right here is only just a dim reflection of what I'm going to be. So I say, oh, come, let us
adore.
Sing it. Oh, come.
Oh, come, let us adore.
He's done too much. I must adore him. Jesus Christ, my Lord, for he come on, somebody, sing it. He alone, by himself, he is worthy. Christ, sing it again. For he alone. Now, for those of you who are already standing, that's fine. Just keep standing. But let me ask this question. If you truly believe that Jesus is who he said he is, and that he will do what he said he will do, and you believe that what he came to do and what he came to give, that he has given that to everyone who has ever believed the gospel, those that Luke said, that thing that is most certainly believed among us, if you believe that to be true for your life, and that God has given you the ministry of reconciliating the world unto Christ, is that your ministry? And then do you have, here's the next question, do you have the ministry of the living expression living inside of you? Then if you do, would you stand in a commitment that you're going to exercise your ministry? I'm going to minister this ministry of reconciliation to somebody today. Oh, come, let us adore him. Come on, somebody. I don't know what you were expecting the Sunday before Christmas. But He's Christ. He's the Lord of hosts, and He's come. We give you all the glory. Oh, Lord. Yes, for what you have done in us and for what you are going to do through us, oh Lord, to our world somewhere today, oh Lord. Sing that one again, oh Lord. We give you. We give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. Oh, for He alone. For He alone. For He alone. For He alone is worthy. Would you close your eyes for just one moment more? I see that everyone in the building, I know there are some sitting that can't stand because of what you're doing. That's fine. But for those of you who have stood, I see that everyone is standing. And by saying that, you answered the question that Christ is in you and that you have a ministry. My question today, is there truly that commitment inside that says, you know what? I'm going to exercise my ministry. That's what Jesus' whole earthly ministry was. To reconcile that which was lost. That which mankind lost. Fellowship with the Father. Dominion to the devil. Lost it. But Jesus Christ took that dominion back when He led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. And then He openly paraded His captors down the streets of heaven, openly embarrassing death, hell, and the grave. He has that power and that dominion in Himself. And now through what He has given us, the spirit of and ministry of reconciliation, we've been given it. We've been reconciled. Now, are we committed? So I'm going to pray. With your head bowed and your eyes closed, I'm going to pray. And you pray along with me as the Spirit leads you to pray. But we're going to pray for God to now, we're already empowered to use this gift. But that God will give us the unction, give us the urge, that gentle push in the Spirit to practice our ministry. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, upon the authority of your word that has just been spoken, by the power of the Holy Ghost in which it was given, and in the name of Jesus, in whose name we live and breathe right now, I speak, Lord, to every single one of these people. I speak, Lord, in their behalf to you, that God, you will minister this unction in them. That, Lord, it will start today. That the ministry of the saints will start to resonate in their spirits, realizing that the person that they're standing in line with at Luby's or at the checkout at Walmart, Lord, that wherever they are on the job, God, even at a red light, look next door to the car beside them and at least nod and smile and mouth the words, God bless you, Merry Christmas. That, Lord, we will actively, today, we will begin actively participating in our ministry. That truly, oh Lord, we are a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid. And Lord, you taught us that no man lights a candle and then puts it under a bushel. No man lights a candle and then puts it under a table. Instead, they set it on a high place so that it gives light to all of the room. So, oh Lord, today in Jesus' name, I pray that through what you have given us, that now, Lord, the urgency of the hour, the push and the drive of the Spirit inside of us now in engaging us into this culture, engaging us into a cancel culture that wants to take away everything that's even points remotely to you. But instead today, God, we're going against the tide. We're swimming upstream, Lord, against everything our culture stands for and against. Lord, we stand for you. We stand for truth. We stand for righteousness. We stand for your word, oh Lord. And in Jesus' name, I speak and commend this word to them right now. In Jesus' name, I commend this word to every one of their spirits. I commend this word into their spirits right now for the glory and the honor of your name. In the glory of your kingdom, in the name of Jesus, I pray. And God, we'll be careful to honor and worship and magnify the one God and Father of all. And it's in your name we pray, Jesus. And everybody said, amen.